How about Alex Ovechkin, huh? One goal shy of yet another 30-goal season. He'd become just the third player in NHL history to score 30 or more goals in at least 14 seasons. You look at the names, he joins up there. Wow. Reed, are you surprised that Ovi's still churning at the pace he's putting these goals out?
Well, I'm a little bit surprised of this year that he's going so fast. I'm not surprised that he's still scoring goals. I just didn't expect him to be on this pace. I mean, 40 to 45 goals, I think, is what everybody would have expected that he goes at, yet he still seems to hit 50 year after year. He seems to be consistent. So the 40 to 45 is where at the start of the year where I would peg him. So, yes, I'm a little surprised that he's doing so well, so consistently, especially after winning a Stanley Cup. That's usually the year that a guy is going to have a little bit of a drop. It's going to take him to Christmas to really start cranking it up because it's a busy, busy summer. There's a lot of emotion going into that. And it's not just the party aspect of it, but it's the fact that your training is put aside because everybody you meet wants to talk or see the cup or do different things, or you're asked to go somewhere so that your training regime is not the same. So I really didn't expect him to come out this season after winning the cup and lead the league and be on pace for record numbers.
What I love about it is he's proven everybody wrong.
Sure.
He disproved everybody because everybody was talking about the party aspect, and he deserved that. They earned that. So too did their fans, all the players. But he worked exceptionally hard, and he looks even better coming into training camp this year. And, oh, by the way, he became a new father as well. So congrats to him and his wife. But the OV plays a unique style. And in all my years in the league, I never heard anybody, not even Braden Holtby, who plays with him, not one goalie that's played with and or against him, say that they can read a shot. You don't know where he's putting it. So it comes off his stick, and it's a surprise every time.
Why is that? Is it the quickness that he gets it off, the release point? What is it?
It's all of that. It's the release point. It's the quickness. It's the velocity with which he shoots. It's the torque. It's the power. It's the acceleration. And look at that wrister, that one goal on poor Jonathan Bernier on that one. He's one player I can't read where the puck is going. And as a goalie, that split-second difference in your inability to read where the puck is going, you're fried. Unless it hits you, you're fried.
A lot of that has to do with the way the stick is created as well, because if the stick has a certain curve or an element to it where your release point, you can push it at different spots on the ice, and the puck will, you can elevate it in tight up here, and that's the thing with Ovechkin. You see him score top glove, top blocker, exactly. Five hole, under the arm, along the ice, over the pad with the same shot, and it all depends where he's releasing the puck, and it's probably in maybe a 10-inch area where he's releasing at different spots and the flex that he puts on the stick and the way the blade is shaped. And I mean, most people probably couldn't shoot with Ovechkin's stick.
Exactly.
But he has a tendency to put it wherever he wants. It's all goal scorers have that knack of manipulating their stick the way they want it, and I mean, nobody can figure it out.
No.
Don't feel bad.
After all these years.
Yeah. You watch it, you're like, how do you do that? Well, don't worry about it. Yeah. Like, even if you watch, I think it was Darling, you were playing Carolina, and Scott Darling had just gotten beaten on a cross ice one-timer by Ovi. Next shot, it's coming on the power play. Darling is there. He's already stopped, and he's in position, and he is, like, he's cheated, and he's there, and it still goes in. All you see him is, he looks up.
Yeah.
And it was just like, okay. Like, he knew it was coming, he was in position, but it still managed to go in.
Ben Raby. Ben, Andrei Burakovsky, and Chandler Stephenson returning to the lineup tonight. What do those guys need to do to stay there?
Yeah, Jameson, I think a lot of attention will be on Andrei Burakovsky tonight, back in the lineup after a four-game absence. Guy the Capitals have long thought has 20-25 goal potential, hasn't quite lived up to those expectations, in part hasn't been able to take advantage of some opportunities in the top six. He said earlier today he wants to go to the net, he wants to be a little bit more creative in his return tonight. I'll say creativity has at times gotten him in trouble. Some of that puck management turnover issues have cost him in the past. And I would say tonight, skating on a third line with Lars Eller and Brett Connolly, ideally if you're Andrei Burakovsky, use the speed, use the wheels that he has, and maybe to an extent be a little cautious, play smart with your fellow line mates in Eller and Brett Connolly. And as far as Stephenson, a key cog on a penalty kill unit, which has been struggling of late. He'll be back after having been a healthy scratch Wednesday night against Pittsburgh.
All right, speaking of back in the lineup, sounds like Brooks Orpik getting closer. He's missed the last 23 games with a knee injury, but he is skating with the team right now. How are Madison Bowie and rookie Jonas Siegenthaler really stepped up in his absence?
Yeah, handling the load, Madison Bowie has very much taken advantage of an opportunity here. He's pretty much been a fixture in the lineup, Bowie has, since early November. This after he had been a healthy scratch throughout the Stanley Cup playoffs last year. He's still looking for his first goal, Madison Bowie, but as far as a defenseman with offensive potential, he's been joining the rush a little bit more. He's acknowledged, he said, he feels more confident in his defensive game. It's allowed him to join the rush a little bit more, and some added responsibility now for Bowie, just in his second year, but all of a sudden he's shepherding the rookie in Jonas Siegenthaler, who tonight will be skating in his ninth career game. So it's a little bit of a green third pair as far as the Capitals are concerned. A couple of youngsters there holding their own, but to your point, an encouraging sign. Brooks Orpik back skating with the team, likely back if not next week, certainly early in 2019.
What's not encouraging right now, the Caps PK, it's been struggling of late and are amongst the most penalized teams right now in the NHL. What adjustments will they make to improve that PK?
Yeah, we referenced the return of Chandler Stephenson tonight, a key cog among the forward group. He'll be back tonight, so potentially that adds a little more depth as far as the forwards are concerned on the PK. Head coach Todd Reirden acknowledged today one of the areas that they've red flagged a little bit have been zone entries from the opposition. The past three games, they've allowed six power play goals against over that three-game stretch. Not good. And one of the areas that they've acknowledged is other teams are gaining the zone too easily. We saw that last Saturday when the Caps last played the Buffalo Sabres. Jack Eichel scored a beautiful goal, what it really was, but it was in transition. It was off the rush. Easily gained the Capitals zone before beating Phoenix Copley for a power play tally. So what area they're looking to clean up? Those zone entries, and again, staying out of the penalty box. Easier said than done, but 13 penalties over that three-game stretch. Far too many from a Capitals perspective.
All right, Ben, the holiday season has arrived, and I know that because the pants are fitting just a little bit tighter these days. What are a few things on the Caps wish list going into the new year?
That's like shopping for the team that has everything, right? As far as the defending Stanley Cup champions, I'll say a couple of things real quick. Number one, every team wants health this time of year, but the Capitals, with the return of Brooks Orpik perhaps coming up, they are still waiting to play their first game this season with what you could say is their optimal lineup. Because of injuries and Tom Wilson's early season suspension, head coach Todd Reirden has yet to have an opportunity this year to put all his eggs sort of in one basket and dress that optimal lineup. So we'll put health on the list. Maybe an eighth career 50-goal season for Alex Ovechkin. That would really be something. And I think also folks in the organization would like to see John Carlson get a little bit more recognition as the year wears on for potentially a Norris Trophy consideration. Finished in the top five last year as far as the votes, but potentially as he continues to enjoy the prime years of his career, maybe a little bit more from John Carlson as far as the national spotlight.
All right, good stuff. Ben, appreciate the time as always, and happy holidays to you and yours.
You're the same, Jameson. Thank you.
Coach Q, he'd be a good fit in a lot of places. A lot of teams on that side would say, yeah, bring him in. He's a future Hall of Fame coach. Do you see a fit in Philly moving forward between what he brings and what that city's looking for?
I mean, based on the history of the Flyers and how financially well off they are as an organization based on Comcast and everything else, sure, I could see a fit being there. But one of the good things for Coach Quenneville is when you're great, you earn options. You earn the option of time. You earn the option of being able to make a real informed decision. And he's in a position that he's put himself in by way of the success that they had, of course, in Chicago and even preceding that. But he's earned the right to be very discerning,
yes,
to be able to hand select whatever situation he feels is best suited for him.
You're and right to ski on the double black diamonds for as long
as you want,
right?
Which
is
another decision.
And he,
exactly,
is, and he will be paid, yes, handsomely for another year after this one.
Yes.
So there is absolutely zero rush, yeah, to make a decision, because there are a lot of teams out there that would even say, if Quenneville's available, I might just have to relieve a good coach of his duties, mm-hmm, to bring in a better coach to get us over the top. But there will be a time, and this happens to all players when you retire, you're at home, there's a length of time, you're injured, there is a time at home, because you're away so much, when you're, especially as a coach, you're at the first guy at the rink, the last guy out, you don't see your family a lot, and when you get in that routine of not seeing your family a lot, other than in summers where you're together all the time, eventually your wife says, isn't it time for you to go to work? And that might be the deciding factor with Joel. It's like, you know what? I got to get back to work, because that's what He does. Yeah. And that's what you do. Trust me, I went through it when I retired. I go through it when the summer starts, and my wife's like,
"I go through it daily."
Isn't there something else you need to be doing? You've been here way too long. Would you get out of the house? So, but no, you're right. Joel will pick and choose when he goes.
Of turning things around, maybe the Hawks doing that over their last five games. You can see the record there, 3-1-1, scoring 19, allowing 17. The power play starting to click, and the PK okay as well. So, Reader, I ask you this, the Hawks playing better of late, too little, too late? I know you were crunching the numbers about mathematics a little bit earlier. What do you think about the Hawks? Is it just too far of a gap to climb over now?
Yeah, I don't have my calculator with me, so I can't sit and say
mathematic. Hold on. No, come on, Reader.
Mathematic work.
Don't try to game up. Tell the people you're doing
like
earlier.
A, it was like a beautiful
mind. So you look
mind.
At it, they're 12-19.
It was like a beautiful
six.
Mind 2 hours
seven,
ago.
So this is how my mind works, and a lot of people in the game, you think the same thing. You're seven games below 500. You played 37. Am I right here? 37 games. You're seven games below 500. What are you going to get in the playoffs? You're going to need 96 points to 98 points. So an 82-game schedule, 96 is you have to be 12 over, or 14 over gives you 96. So if you want to be 96, which I don't even think got you in last year, so that's
It's
14 games over, exactly. It's 14 games over. You're seven games under right now. So that means you need to be 21 games over in that 19 to 21 games over 500, which means if you've got, what do we have, 45 games remaining.
Yep.
If you are in that ballpark of 13 and 20, where are we, 25? Is that 35?
Yeah.
Anyhow.
I like
it. The math shows it's just they've got to play ridiculously good. They've got to be in about the 750 percentage of winning. So you look at how far under they are, 500, how far over they have to be, and then the games remaining. That's crazy winning percentage. The top teams in the league don't win at that percentage. Now, if they do it, good for them. They're in. But mathematically, and again, I didn't do math much past high school. So mathematically, when I do my math, I'm like, wow, that's a tough one. For the best teams in the league to play at that level, that's a tough one. So for the Chicago Blackhawks, the hole might just be a little too deep.
Second wild card out west, Avs last year got in with 95 points. So a couple hours ago, Reader had the calculator, supercomputer, abacus. He was going, and you just said... It's an uphill climb, probably Steve. Improbable. Yeah. What is the mindset of the leaders on this team who have won the three cups and now they're going through a stretch of games like they're going through right now?
Well, I mean, knowing those guys, they're all frustrated, but they're all highly professional, every one of them. Attention to detail is what really has allowed them all to be great players and impact players and also winners. So they're doing all those same things on a day-to-day basis, which if you're a young player or a middle-aged player that's come into the Blackhawks, you can't help but learn from that. And if you don't, then that's on you because you're getting all the examples of what it takes to be a successful NHLer. So, of course, this is a steep decline from who they are, where they've been, how esteemed they are as a team. But Jonathan Toews, Patrick Kane, of course, Seabrook, Keith, all those guys do things the exact same way from a professional standpoint. And they're going to approach every single game, every workout, all those things that they do that make them who they are, they'll continue doing them. It's just that there's a frustration about the fact that it's been a kind of a steep decline by way of their excellence standards.
How about having a game like the Winter Classic on your schedule when you're going through a season like this? Maybe it's something you can circle on the calendar and that's your season right there kind of
well,
thing.
Well, it is. I wouldn't say it's your season, but you used the word compartmentalize earlier in the show. They compartmentalize and say, I'm going to worry about today. I'm going to worry about this next five-game segment. We want to win 3 of 5. We have to get to 700, so we've got to get 7 of the next 10 points. And you work your way through it. And you don't look at the big picture. You don't look at the standings. I've been on teams when the team wasn't that good. You flip the standings around so that in the locker room, you're actually near the top when you're near the bottom. So your psyche is, hey, you know what? We just need to worry about what we need to do now, not what we need to do in February or where we're going to be at the end of March. And that's where the Blackhawks are. They know where they are. But also, I say it all the time, you don't tell a professional athlete you can't, because it's like we're sitting here and I'm giving you the math and not very good math saying that, hey, it's a steep climb. And they're like, all right, you know what? Well, watch, it is a steep climb, but we're going to do our best to prove everybody wrong. And that's where you're at. So you shrink it down into smaller segments and you take the good out of those segments. You want your PP to be 25%. You want your PK to be up in that 90 percentile for these five games. You want to get 7 of 10 points. All right, we achieved that. Next five game segment. We want to win the Winter Classic. We want to, you know, that's how you do it. And at the end of the season, you put it all together and you're like, okay, you know, where are we? Where did we start? Where did we end? So, I mean, it's a difficult stretch. It's a difficult stretch when you're looking at the standings and you're on the bottom. But, you know, they will make the best of it. They're too good. I mean, their players are too good. They're too professional. You said it, Weeksy.
No.
Welcome in, NHL Network signer Elliot Friedman. Elliot, it's never too early to start talking the trade deadline. It sounds like one of the teams in action tonight could be making some buzz come trade deadline, the Colorado Avalanche. What's the latest on them?
Well, they're a really talented team. There's no question about it, Jameson. But I think when you take a look, especially in their division, the top contenders who would generally be seen as Nashville and Winnipeg, they're much deeper than Colorado is. And I think the biggest question that we're going to have for them is, do they believe that this is a year where they go in to win it all? They have a super line. The top two scorers of the National Hockey League, a guy named Gabriel Landeskog, who is getting close to setting a career high for goals. And we're not even at the halfway point of the season yet. And so you're looking at them and you're saying they're talented. They've got everything you think you should have. Defense, high scoring, goaltending, but they're not deep. And I think people are wondering, are they going to take all those assets? And they have a lot of them, especially from the Matt Duchene trade, and pour them into guys who maybe can help them challenge this year. And one name that's been linked to them has been Kevin Hayes of the Rangers. There have maybe been some others, depending on what Ottawa's willing to do. I think the question is going to be, does Colorado decide they're going to go all in for this season?
All right, interesting. Speaking of going all in, the Hurricanes just want to go all in on a goal scorer right now. They had Jeff Skinner. He's in Buffalo. He's putting up serious points right now. What about Carolina's interest in a guy like Vladimir Tarasenko?
Well, we were talking about this, Jameson, last week on Hockey Night in Canada, and we believe that the Hurricanes have had some interest in him, and it's been known between them and the Blues for some time now, probably a few weeks. And, you know, and Nick was the guy who led the charge on it last week, after it was reported, you know, someone joked with me, you guys were late on this one. Like, this has been something that's been discussed for a bit. So I think they are interested. It's a complicated deal. Like, anytime you're dealing for a guy like that, I'm sure that St. Louis would love to hear potential interest from other teams around the league, and I think they have. But one of the players that I think St. Louis is interested in is Martin Nekas, who's one of Carolina's highly rated prospects, who's played very well this year in the American Hockey League for a Charlotte team that's doing really well. And I just don't know. I think that's going to be a big price for Carolina to give up, and I'm not sure if that's a road they want to go down. So that's something they're weighing, but yes, they are definitely interested in Tarasenko, and I'm sure more are too.
All right, what about Vegas? They sit just outside the top three in the Pacific right now with 42 points. Who might they be eyeing? Who might they be targeting come trade deadline time as far as a potential addition down the stretch?
Well, one of the things everybody jokes about is that if there's a player that played in the Western Hockey League, Vegas is interested in them. So everybody kind of laughs about that. So whenever you suggest somebody, like the man at the bottom of your screen there, Braden Schenn, the thing that's interesting about him is he played 3 years for the Brandon Wheat Kings of the Western Hockey League. The assistant general manager of the Vegas Golden Knights is Kelly McCrimmon, who is synonymous with the Brandon Wheat Kings. He coached them, he owns them, he runs them. He has a big presence there. And so I think as St. Louis looks to decide what they're going to do with their team and their players as they try to figure out what's going on in this season, it's a little bit of educated guess, but it's some informed speculation. I think that he's a guy that Vegas is looking at, and Schenn is a guy who could help a lot of teams. He can play a lot of spots in your lineup, and he's a tough guy. So I could definitely see him fitting into what Vegas would be willing to do.
Maybe the biggest name out there right now is the head coach, Joel Quenneville. After Dave Hextall was relieved of his duties, there were a lot of reports out there saying, Q, perfect fit in Philadelphia, but you're saying it's not exactly a slam dunk. You're giving us the Dikembe Mutombo. Not today.
Yes, but I can't do it with the style and flair that Dikembe does.
Oh, yes, the big man.
Well, hey, you know what? It's the way it's going right now. They're 2-0 in the Scott Gordon and Carter Hart era, so maybe that's the key for Philadelphia. Who knows? But, yes, there's no question. There have been lots of links from Joel Quenneville to Philadelphia. You don't have to look very hard to find them. You know, the one thing is, Joel Quenneville, first of all, he came out to Andy Strickland, a reporter in St. Louis, and he denied that he was going to Philadelphia. That's number one. Number two, Quenneville is skiing in Colorado, and if you're an avid skier, it's not easy to drag you off the slopes at this time of the year. Number three, there's a chance he may be going away on vacation with his family pretty soon. So I think that he's just clearly decided to take his time, and why not? I think if you're in that position, you're getting paid pretty handsome money to relax, you can relax and take your time. And look, Philly's got money. There's no question they're going to make it worth Joel Quenneville's while financially to coach them. But I also think he's a guy who wants to win, wants to come back into a winning situation. And right now, although they've looked great their last two games, Philly's got a bit to sort out. I wouldn't be surprised if Quenneville's ideal situation is to wait and see what develops the rest of the year, how the playoffs go. There's going to be some good team always loses early, Jameson, as you know. And then they might sit there and say, you know what, Joel Quenneville, he could help us. And that's what I think Joel Quenneville's going to wait to see. Try to pick as perfect an opportunity as he can to go next time. And that's why I don't think Philly's a slam dunk. I think the Flyers still have some stuff to prove. And I think that he wants to see potentially what else could be out there.
All right, interesting stuff. I listen to your podcast and enjoy it. So I've heard a time or two you used to cover the NBA. So I figured you'd like that basketball reference.
Jameson, I'm going to tell Amal and Jeff, and Amal produces it, and Jeff's my co-host, that you did that.
Oh,
they're going to love the so people good, outside right? of Sportsnet are ripping me for that line.
Oh, the coffee money must be up to about $1,000 by now. But Elliot Friedman, happy holidays to you and your family. We appreciate your insight and your hard work, and we'll talk to you down the road, okay?
Jameson, you too. It's my pleasure. Happy holidays. Merry Christmas to everybody watching tonight.
All right. Thanks, Elliot. Lauren Gardner of Altitude Sports joining us on the show right now to get us set for this one tonight. Lauren, how important are these last two games for Colorado before the holiday break?
They're huge. I mean, following that 8-day, 4-game road trip on the East Coast, which concluded with a really tough loss to the Lightning, Jared Bednar addressed the media and his team, and he said, today begins the sprint to the Christmas break, which is 7 games, 12 days. So far, 5 games in, they're 2-2-1. And it's been a really inconsistent stretch for the Avs, whether it be lack of secondary scoring, a little bit of difficulty there with the goaltending situation. The penalty kill has really been struggling as of late, too. But they are in good shape if you're looking at this playoff picture. They're just 4 points out of that top spot in the West. So these two games are crucial for this team in order just to go into that break with a little bit of peace of mind and to start off that new year on a good note.
The Avs certainly one of those must-watch TV teams every single night because of that top line. They continue to dominate. Why are those three guys so important to the Avs right now?
They're so important. 28 points over the last 5 games combined. That win over Montreal just 2 nights ago, they accounted for all 5 scoring points in that contest. It's just so fun to watch them play. And every time I try and talk to them about it, you know, sometimes I get tired of telling the story, but they always make themselves the headline. And, you know, it was interesting talking to Nathan MacKinnon about them. And he was just saying that, you know, we don't really communicate that much on the ice. The anticipation is just there. We can tell where one another is going to be. We know how we're going to play out there. And, you know, I did find one fun tie-in because I know we talk about this top line so much, Jameson. It was last year against the Chicago Blackhawks following a really tough loss to Las Vegas that this line was born, that Jared Bednar put this combination together, and obviously the rest is history.
Incredible. Incredible that it's been that long, and these guys have just put up the points like they have. Let's go to the net right now. Filip Grubauer, Semyon Varlamov have kind of been splitting time between starts in the net right now. Who gets the nod tonight?
It's going to be Filip Grubauer. He is 8-0-3 in his last 11 starts. And Jared Bednar even said that he had a discussion with both goaltenders who've kind of been struggling as of late, with the exception of that Wednesday night game where Filip Grubauer was really solid between the pipes. He said one of these guys needs to step up to begin the season. Semyon Varlamov was given the benefit of the doubt, and he was kind of named the starter for this club. He went 4-0-2. And, you know, he said that these guys were able to cover up a lot of the mistakes for the Avs that they made early on in the season. But recently, they have seen their fair share of struggles. So right now, it's Philip Grubauer. Tomorrow night on the second of the back-to-back.
That was how you cap off an interview. Yeah. I didn't hear the last 15 words he said, but I'll go with it was great analysis because it always is. Lauren, thank you so much. Enjoy the game tonight and happy holidays.
Appreciate it, Jameson. Take
All right.
care. Happy
thank
holidays.
Thank you very much. Holiday wish list. Weeksy, I'll start with you. Yeah. What is the top of your holiday wish list that you want to see happen by the end of the season?
You know, we are very fortunate to cover the entire league and the entire world of hockey, really. But I think a very compelling story right now happening is what's going on in Buffalo. It's been a lot of fun to watch. They've got a lot of great fans up there. They live for their sports teams. And it would be amazing for the Sabres to be able to get in for their passionate fans up there in the Queen City. They've suffered long enough, and now they're a rays of hope. The top line is arguably the top line in the league. Jack Eichel's playing like a player that's possessed, taking his game to new heights. Rasmus Dahlin is everything we could have hoped for and more. Carter Hutton and Ullmark stabilizing things in the net. So Housley's done a nice job. They're a lot of fun to watch, and suddenly now this team has turned the corner in a way that we probably didn't anticipate happening this quickly. So hats off to them. Hats off to Jason Botterill and what he did in the offseason as well. I'd love to see some playoff hockey up in Buffalo and hear Rick Jeanneret and our boys
here
Dupper.
Here I am and just see Chippewa Street.
Exactly.
Is in a playoff
That's
street.
Right. Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
That'd be wild.
Of course.
All right, what do you want to see, Reader? What's on the top of your holiday wish list?
I want to see a 60-goal scorer in the National Hockey League. That's what I want to see.
We got a few guys on pace.
We do. These are our last five. But let's go back 28 years. Nine. We've only had nine guys to score 60-plus goals. It's happened 12 times because a few of them, like Lemieux, Brett Hull, and Pavel Bure did it twice since the 1990-91 season. But I want to see Ovi get to 60 once again. That is so exciting when a player can reach that milestone of 60 goals. We haven't seen it since Steven Stamkos did it. And the way the goals are going in for Ovi this year, I really think that 60 goals is definitely in the picture. So for me, I want to see a 60-goal score. And to even have multiple 60-goal scores or multiple 50-goal scores
would
be good. But I want to see a 60-goal guy. I think that would be that would be awesome.
Austin Matthews on pace for 60 or more.
It's incredible.
Despite missing 14 games.
Yes, yeah.
My holiday wish is this guy just stays healthy. So we
as fans
can witness his greatness. He's incredible. He had 4 points last night, 19 goals in 21 games. And as I mentioned, he's on pace for over 60. So I just want him to stay healthy. All the elite play, everybody in the league, just stay healthy. I know it's a tough sport and, you know, injuries are going to happen. But this guy in particular, I just want him to stay healthy so we can witness what he can do.
I echo
on a
that.
Basis.
I echo so that with capital letters, man. I love watching him play.
Oh, yeah. You and everybody in the Toronto area and Toronto Maple Leafs fans, because when he's in, he is absolutely electric.
Yeah.
His shot is scary.
Time for the NHL Hat Trick Challenge presented by Enterprise here with Kevin Weeks. And you said the hat tricks were going until they weren't.
Yeah.
What's going on?
It's
like the
it's
price
called
is
a
right.
holiday
the yodeler,
pause.
Right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, the holiday break. Everybody's on it.
This is what it is. But I got to turn that around.
Yeah, let's get that magic going.
Let's do it.
Preds, Bruins, matinee game. Who do you got in that one?
I'll go with the Preds. It's been a tough stretch for both of these teams, really, by way of injuries. They've been besieged by injuries. And a lot of their top players, make no mistake about it. But I think the Nashville Predators, just based on their D, they're always in games. They have the ability to score goals based on the depth of their defensive core. But I don't anticipate this will be a sleepy matinee. Pete Laviolette, a proud Boston guy, so I'm going to go with the Preds on this one.
All right, how about JVR, James Van Riemsdyk? Does he score a goal on Saturday?
I'm going to say yes because he's always running around the net. Anytime you're around the net and you have a willingness to get there and you have the hands that he does in and around the net, you increase your potential for scoring goals exponentially. So I think JVR ends up getting on the board. Why not? It's been a tough start to the year by way of injuries, but nice to see him back and doing his thing.
All right, heavyweight tilt out west, King Sharks Saturday. Who are you taking?
I'll go with the Sharks in this one. The San Jose Sharks are still really loaded. This is a team that can score in different ways, and you look at other guys that are somewhat unsung, like Timo Meier, who's having a tremendous season for them right now. Evander Kane's heated up of late, but their captain, Little Joe, has been amazing. Jumbo Joel Thornton continues to eclipse milestones and set new records on a day-to-day basis and continues climbing up the charts. So I'll go with the Sharks.
All right, I think you're getting one. I like these ones. Right. You got the Preds over the Bees. You got JVR getting a goal, and you got the Sharks taking down the Kings. Play NHL Hat Trick Challenge daily for the chance to win the $20,000 regular season grand prize, and until January 25th for your chance to win the $10,000 Period 2 prize.
Three stars of the night. Your first star goes to New Jersey's Taylor Hall after a four-point night. The second star is Capitals goalie Braden Holtby and his 36 saves. And the third star goes to Matt Duchene, who scored twice in his return from injury.
A very festive Friday night.
The holiday season is upon us.
We're ready to go. Scores! What a dazzling display. Oh, somehow remarkably was it kept out of the net. And the fans are loving it here.
Oh, my goodness gracious.
Just sensational. That's the only way to describe it.
And I love when the youngsters make a good play.
Holtby way out of the cage.
He was sliding into second base like he was at Nationals Park.
Beautiful pass with the big kahoot. I mean, that was just a perfect play.
This is a heck of a hockey game here.
Dowd throwing it ahead. Stevenson with a good speed. Stevenson's in. He scores! Chandler Stevenson, shorthanded.
The alley-oop from Dowd was spectacular. What a dazzling display.
Here's Kerfoot behind the net. John Frank scores!
J.T. Kupfer! Perfect feed from Kerfoot.
Pressed to line it in a foot race. Holtby is coming, and he'll come out to play it. But then it got onto the stick of Connor Sherry. He was sliding into second base like he was at Nationals Park.
Dillon drops a pass back. Shabbat with a shot. Save made! Oh, somehow remarkably wasn't kept out of the net. Hacked out here by the Devils. Palmieri tries to push this out of the zone. He'll skate it out of chaos. Palmieri, Hall scores!
Oh, my! And the Devils make an incredible defensive play.
Here's a look at the top 10 goals from the past week.
Here's McKinnon, not in front, shot, save by Price, rebound, score!
It's a good goal! Game Landeskog got a mid-air able to bag it home for his 23rd of the season.
Well, who else? Who else this year is going to score this kind of goal?
Coyotes will break it back. Derek Stepan, the former Ranger, over the line. He shoots, he scores!
I don't necessarily associate Derek Stepan with a great wrister. Like, you know, that's not really the forte of his game. But he put a little extra heat on that one
to put
it by his old teammate Henrik Lundqvist, who hadn't seen him go bar down like that in a while.
Tipped up ahead, and the Flyers try to dance in. Lawton shoots, scores. Scott Lawton gets one back for the Flyers.
Lawton just buries it. Look at that bouncing, and he does real well to knock that bouncing puck to himself on the forehand once, twice. And he's in alone and elevates a puck that was on edge. Terrific play by Scott Lawton.
Helping out, Tom Wilson comes rumbling into the picture. Kuznetsov's feed. Fire and score! Jacob Vrana with a rocket.
That baby was Ovechkin-esque. What a slap shot from number 13.
2-on-1 with Beauvillier. Barzell drags. Wait. Score!
So much poise, so much skill. Sees him all the way, knows he's going to pass. He makes absolutely no mistake.
Backhands it up, not out. Kept alive by McKinnon. Racing down low for Rantanen with a shot. He scores! Mikko Rantanen!
He just pounced, I mean, attacked. McKinnon drops it back. Rantanen, eyeball to eyeball with Anton Khudobin. Rips it high glove.
Backstrom one more time. You look through the slot, defer to Carlson, hammered by Ovechkin, right in! The hat trick for Alex Ovechkin.
What do you got to say? I mean,
yeah,
it really is.
Incredible.
And to think that people thought maybe he might have a slow start because of the Stanley Cup emotional hangover, whatever it might be, he is now bursting ahead of the pace he had when he scored 65.
Yeah.
for Barry, a drive, blocked. What an
effort.
And a breakaway for O'Reilly in overtime. Can he be the hero? Yes! Yeah! Goodbye, good night. What a game.
What a play by Robert Bortuzzo. He blocked one, then he blocks another, and punches it ahead to the former Av, Ryan O'Reilly. Backhand, forehand, and thanks for coming. It's game over for the Blues.
Eichel, full steam ahead, gets in over the Washington line and dragged it right through and took a shot. He scores! Jack Eichel! Oh my, what a play! Coming soon to a theater near you, Sick Mitts, starring Jack Eichel. There was so much talent on display in about 10 seconds, it was incredible.
Bufflin will send it across. Laine in with it. Patrick Laine to the net. Poke check. Leon scores! Mark Scheifele! Game over! His third overtime winner of the season. Seventh career overtime goal for Mark Scheifele, who now ties the franchise record.
The guy's got the magic stick in overtime.
Here's a look at the top 10 plays from the past week.
Backhands it up, not out, to the line by McKinnon, racing down low for Rantanen with a shot. He scores! Mikko Rantanen!
Rantanen, eyeball to eyeball with Anton Khudobin, rips it high glove.
Now Backman at the line, back after missing four with a concussion, turned over, Tkachuk. What a save! Are you kidding me? By Jake Allen on Tkachuk.
He is absolutely robbed there.
Backstrom one more time. You look through the slot, defer to Carlson, hammered by Ovechkin, right in! The hat trick for Alex Ovechkin. An absolute bullet. And Alex Ovechkin is tied for sixth.
Up top, he and Ristolainen change places. Ristolainen's one timer! Oh my goodness!
And he kept it out of the net! Luongo reached behind him and got a glove on it.
Somehow spins around, finds it, swept it out of danger. Now comes Ovechkin. Ovechkin drifted in, played it on a cross for a shot. Oh, McMurray on a diving play into the front of the net. Did it cross the line? The net was dislodged as the puck trickled near the line.
You can't get much closer. And Pettersson just dives and keeps this puck from completely crossing the goal line. And Pettersson dives and keeps it out.
For Barry, a drive, blocked. What an
effort.
And a breakaway for O'Reilly in overtime. Can he be the hero? Yes!
Yeah!
Goodbye, good night. What a game.
What a play by Robert Bortuzzo. He blocked one, then he blocks another, and punches it ahead to the former Av, Ryan O'Reilly. Backhand, forehand, and thanks for coming. It's game over for the Blues.
David Krejci takes it wide on Johnson, center back across, chance for Marchand! And he's robbed by DeSmith! The Snow Angel in the crease. Marchand didn't get all of it, but a miraculous stop falling backward from Casey DeSmith.
What a play! Casey DeSmith!
He's making a run. He wants to be the goalie there. I think there's an opportunity.
There is an opportunity.
Someone's got to step up and take it.
Making the most of that opportunity.
But Marchessault is checked by Zuccarello. Giveaway. Carlson shoots. Save. Rebound. Save. What a save by Lundqvist. Unbelievable. Oh, that net was wide open. And he robbed Carlson a second time. They're still buzzing about it.
And that was Carlson that read it, gets his own rebound, and that is about as good as it gets.
Eichel. Full steam ahead, gets in over the Washington line and dragged it right through and took a shot, he scores! Jack Eichel! Oh my, what a play! Coming soon to a theater near you, Sick Mitts, starring Jack Eichel. There was so much talent on display in about 10 seconds, it was incredible.
Bufflin will send it across, Laine in with it, Patrick Laine to the net, Puk check, Leon scores! Shankly, game
overtime winner of the season. Seventh career overtime goal for Mark Scheifele, who now ties the franchise record.
The guy's got the magic stick in overtime.
Here's a look now at the top 10 saves from the last week.
Bats it back down to Coyle off the outside of the net. And Koivu robbed by Jones.
How in the world did that one stay out of the goal?
Martin Jones playing out of his mind here.
Yeah, he's had to make a couple of the saves of the spectacular nature here in the third period.
Slowly in over the line with a pass to Monahan. Stopped by Dubnyk. Great save, Dubnyk off Monahan, who walked right in and was shut down.
Sean Monahan, who just has a knack of getting open and in behind defenders, and you can see that collision after with Dubnyk. Dubnyk get a right pad on that save. I mean, it's just desperation at that point.
You know, flying V to make that stop.
Donato with a good body check. Heinen back to Donato. Steps in front. Oh, what a save by Ullmark. Down and out.
Donato protected the blue line, teed one up, and then this move here. Toe drag, curl and drag. You think he's got nothing but net. Somehow Ullmark on his back, able to get it with the glove.
Drops it back. Savard with a shot. Came off the end board. Oh, did Blackwood make the save? Yes! As he denies Wennberg at the side of the net.
Blackwood does a great job of sealing that right skate to the right post. I don't even know where the puck is, Kanji.
Parisi has Coyle. Parisi to Coyle. Saved by Riddick.
Right up the ice, a two-on-one, and Riddick just reads this pass across from Parisi to Coyle and gets that left pad on it.
Oh, great stop. David Riddick's fifth save of the hockey game so far. Now Backlund at the line, back after missing four with a concussion. Turned over, Tkachuk. What a save! Are you kidding me? By Jake Allen on Tkachuk.
Great reaction. We talked in the last game with Jake Allen. That glove is like butter right now. But he is absolutely robbed there.
Up top, he and Ristolainen change places. Ristolainen's one-timer! Oh my goodness!
And he kept it out of the net! Luongo reached behind him and got a glove on it.
Somehow spins around, finds it, swept it out of danger.
Now comes Ovechkin. Ovechkin drifted in, played it on a cross for a shot. Oh, McMurray on a diving play made to the front of the net. Did it cross the line? The net was dislodged as the puck trickled near the line.
You can't get much closer. And Pettersson just dives and keeps this puck from completely crossing the goal line. And Pettersson dives and keeps it out.
David Krejci takes it wide on Johnson. Center back across. Chance for Marchand! And he's robbed by DeSmith. The Snow Angel in the crease. Marchand didn't get all of it, but a miraculous stop falling backward from Casey DeSmith.
What a play! Casey DeSmith.
He's making a run. He wants to be the goalie there. I think there's an opportunity.
There is an opportunity.
Someone's got to step up and take it.
Making the most of that opportunity.
But Marchessault is checked by Zuccarello. Giveaway. Carlson shoots. Save. Rebound. Save. What a save by Lundqvist. Unbelievable. Oh, that net was wide open. And he robbed Carlson a second time. They're still buzzing about it.
And that was Carlson that read it, gets his own rebound, and that is about as good as it gets.
Here is a look at the top 10 goals from 2018.
Final seconds, Matheson, McCann back for Matheson. Can he get one final shot? Spinning in is Matheson. Gorgeous play and he scores. You gotta be kidding me. Mike Matheson hits the highlight reel. The goal with less than a second left makes it 2-1.
Spies is back for the puck in trouble against Smith Pelly. Howl is there to the blue line. Orpik kept the puck in, score!
And it's Devontae Smith Pelly on a
Crosby working on Shen there. Now Crosby comes out along the goal line, pumps one towards the net. Is it in? It is, and there it is. Sidney Crosby, a milestone marker in St. Louis. His 400th career goal has tied this game early in the second.
Back the other way come the Devils. Stafford ahead for Coleman. Backhand try, scores! Oh, Blake Coleman, what a gorgeous backhander to beat Murray.
This is just terrific stuff. What a goal from Blake Coleman.
Down to Ben. Out to Hamuse. Nobody in front. Deflection! A beauty! Ben! Oh, wow! What a goal! What a goal for Tyler Pitlick! If at first you don't succeed, try again.
Couture right up the middle, into the zone to LeBanc. Drops it for Pavelski, and now Burns had it tipped away. William Karlsson looking for his second shorthanded goal in as many nights. And shot, score! What a goal!
Are you kidding me? Might have the goal of the year. Well, there is your goal of the year, William Karlsson, number 42.
Goes after the puck, Petrangelo in there as well. Little in front, here's Laine, scores! It's a high five for Patrick Laine.
What a remarkable feat this is right now. Look at the boys, they're all watching the replay.
The first five-goal game since Johan Franzen did it with Detroit back in 2011. Remarkable night for Patrick Laine.
Sending it back in along the left-hand side. 7:40 to go. Puck in front. Connolly, what a chance! They score! They score! The puck on a rebound for Lars Eller! The Tiger pouncing at the moments that he can potentially be the hero. Happens along the boards, but Crosby digs it out, tries to feed. Gensel knocked out of the air. Crosby, unbelievable goal! He flipped it up to himself and then into the back of the net.
A bat and a chip in behind Carey Price like he's done it a million times.
Well, it was a huge goal for us. You know, he scores goals from unique situations. He thinks the game on such a level that a lot of players don't even consider trying to put pucks on the net in certain situations or batting them out of the air the way he does. He's just an elite player.
Coming in front, loose in front of Hellebuyck, lost his goal stick. Wilson with a chance. Rebound, they score! And there it is! On the rebound, Alex Ovechkin, the 20th player in National Hockey League history to score 600 goals in his soon-to-be Hall of Fame career!
Here is a look at the top 10 plays from 2018.
Spies is back for the puck in trouble against Smith Pelly. Howell is there to the blue line. Orpik kept the puck in, score!
And it's Devontae Smith Pelly on a save at a left point. DSP save of the day. We're tied at three with 10:08 to go. How about Devontae? The Caps with life here in game five.
No bigger goal with the Stanley Cup on the line than that one.
Crosby working on Shen there. Now Crosby comes out along the goal line, pumps one towards the net. Is it in? It is, and there it is. Sidney Crosby, a milestone marker in St. Louis. His 400th career goal has tied this game early in the second.
Picks up a trailer, save made by Kincaid. Back the other way come the Devils. Stafford ahead for Coleman. Backhand try, scores! Oh, Blake Coleman, what a gorgeous backhander to beat Murray.
This is just terrific stuff. What a goal from Blake Coleman.
Down to Ben. Out to Hamuse, nobody in front. Deflection, a beauty, Ben! Oh, wow, what a goal! What a goal for Tyler Pitlick! If at first you don't succeed, try again.
Couture right up the middle, into the zone to LeBanc. Drops it for Pavelski, and now Burns had it tipped away. William Karlsson looking for his second shorthanded goal in as many nights, and shot, score! What a goal!
Are you kidding me? Might have the goal of the year.
Well, there is your goal of the year, William Karlsson, number 42.
goes after the puck. Petrangelo in there as well. Little in front. Here's Laine. Scores! It's a high five for Patrick Laine.
What a remarkable feat this is right now. Look at the boys. They're all watching the replay.
The first five-goal game since Johan Franzen did it with Detroit back in 2011. Remarkable night for Patrick Laine.
Sending it back in along the left-hand side. 7:40 to go. Puck in front. Connolly, what a chance! They score! They score! The puck on a rebound for Lars Eller! The Tiger pouncing at the moment that he can potentially be the hero.
At the edge of the crease, and now the hash marks as it's still back in. And set a close!
Incredible stop by Braden Holtby.
It happens along the boards, but Crosby digs it out, tries the feed. Gensel knocked out of the air. Crosby, unbelievable goal! He flipped it up to himself and then into the back of the net.
A bat and a chip in behind Carey Price like he's done it a million times.
Well, it was a huge goal for us. You know, he scores goals from unique situations. He thinks the game on such a level that a lot of players don't even consider trying to put pucks on the net in certain situations or batting them out of the air the way he does. He's just an elite player.
Coming in front, loose in front of Hellebuyck, lost his goal stick. Wilson with a chance. Rebound, they score! And there it is! On the rebound, Alex Ovechkin, the 20th player in National Hockey League history to score 600 goals in soon-to-be Hall of Fame career.
Here's a look at the top 10 saves from 2018.
Leaves it for Skinner. Skinner dances around Hayes, goes right to the net. On goal, what a stop by Lundqvist! Threw his arm up in the air, lost his stick, and made the save.
And that's just a fabulous save. Unbelievable save. Pad save. Played off the boards. Aaron left it over in front for guess who? Great save by Riddick. And all the time in the world to make this play as he goes to the backhand. And a perfect save by Riddick as he just stones him with the glove.
Here's Manning, slap shot, deflected in front by Anisimov, stopped by Smith, rebound, Anisimov, somehow that stayed out.
Maybe the save of the year in the National Hockey League. Right part of your screen, there's Anisimov, he's got a wide open net, and look at the skate save by Mike Smith. He's down, he's out, and he takes his right leg and lifts it up. Nylander found the net, a save by Vasilevsky. What a great glove save there. Had been saved into the goal line. Marlowe robbed down low.
Did he save that with the back of his leg when he kicked backwards?
Yeah, he did.
And then he just, without even, like, how can you feel the puck with those pads on?
And steers it wide. Now Wheeler, cross-ice pass and a big save by Fleury. And then he scrambles back across. Stop Scheifele.
Two wonderful saves. One, and now how about that position to get back?
This is something else.
That was Gudas. And the Flyers get the puck, and the outlet is on the money. Giroux cutting on in. Oh, Fleury robs him. What a save by Marc-Andre Fleury. Never gives up on a play, reaches back, and keeps this game scoreless.
And Fleury gets the glove there in time. The reaction from Giroux, great. He can't believe it.
Here's Tory Krug walking in.
Near side, Krejci, pass back the other side. Anderson diving. I don't know if he got a piece of that. I think he did. If he did, it's an enormous save.
That would be the most spectacular save of the playoff.
Look at the reaction of Anderson, and wow. Oh, right across the goal line. That. Well, it couldn't have been any better played by the Leaf netminder.
Weaves his way through neutral ice. Biega over the line. Dangles his way through. Biega, a dish. Oh, my goodness! Peterson kept it out! How did he make that save?
Calvin Peterson reached back with the glove and gets it.
Unbelievable.
On range, Backstrom bid is turned away. A pickpocket from Wilson. There's Ovechkin. Oh, my goodness! What an incredible stop by Carey Price. You must be kidding me.
Wilson and Ovechkin did everything right.
How about the two stars acknowledging one another at the end of that play? I mean, that is special.
Watch Ovi's reaction. Watch. He gets all this puck down on one knee a la Brett Hull. Look, let me just give you a standing O, dog.
Awesome.
Let me give you a standing O.
That's
great. I love that.
At the edge of the crease, and now the hash marks as it's dealt back in. And Sinekos. Oh, and it didn't go. It was Tuck with a wide open net.
Incredible stop by Braden Holtby. The puck goes across. Tuck has a wide open net. And the paddle of the stick, Holtby.
In Washington, they'll be calling this the save.